Hi, today I'm here with Mark Miller, longtime RHS football coach. And what we're going to be doing over this holiday season is revisiting some times past where the Rochester Zebra football team in 1987, we're going to show the state championship game, as well as the Lady Zebras from 2004 and the Boys Zebras from 2009 in basketball. So revisiting some happy times as athletic director. I remember all three of those were probably pretty significant memories.
Oh, absolutely. Very happy times. No question about that.
Well, today you have over 200 wins at Rochester High School, but today we're going to talk about what probably was your biggest, the 1987 state championship.
Well, no question. Of all the games you can talk about, we can talk about some good comebacks and things like that, but that game had a little bit of everything. It was a great comeback. It was phenomenal atmosphere, and obviously it's what you as a coach dream about doing, eventually making it down to the state and being successful. And we're down there against one of the Marion County Catholic schools, and none of those had lost a state championship up until that game. So,
is that right?
Yeah, so we were the first. So,
well, that's a great thing. Huge crowd. I mean, fantastic football game, 23-20, so.
We had a remarkable crowd. I mean, there's a spot where we just scan the stands as part of the tape that the people will see, and from 20 to 20, they were just packed, and we sold a remarkable amount of tickets. I'm not sure that there was anybody left in Rochester in 1987 on that day in November. But
I think you're right.
Yeah, it was a great opportunity.
Well, to kind of set the scene, 1984, the seniors you have playing on this football team were freshmen.
Absolutely.
And they went 4-6 against a murderous schedule. So could you kind of see things starting to turn around for Zebra football in 84?
Well, in 84 was a situation where we knew we were going to be young. We knew we were going to be inexperienced, and we almost totally platooned that year. Just with the idea that we need to get these young kids, these freshmen, these sophomores, and some of these guys a lot of good experience. And as it worked out, we ended up winning 3 out of our last 4 ball games. And we were able to kind of take that into the 95 season, or 85.
Right.
Yeah, right. 85 season. And then, 85 we turned around. We won our first sectional. Mm-hmm. We lost a very close game to Fort Wayne Bishop Lures. In 1985, in the driving rain, sleet, slush, whatever it was during that period of time,
and 9-3.
Yeah, it was, it was a battle. It was a game in which we had led the majority of the ball game, but they had a young man by the name of Cal Miller that went on and rushed for 265 yards in the state championship game.
Right.
And then went on and went to Michigan State and finished at IU, I believe.
Is that right?
Yeah.
I can remember that.
Yep.
That was a great game. I think PGA Pro Chris Smith was your quarterback in that game.
Yeah, he was. He was. I always kid him a little bit about that whenever I see him or whenever I'm talking about him. I introduce him, and I did the same thing when I introduced him to the Hall of Fame as the quarterback of the 1985 Zebras. I eventually mentioned his golf his golf game, but he was a quarterback on that team, but a lot of key pieces of that team were there. Tim Walker was a starter, actually Steve Ruckman. Mm-hmm. We started him at in a flanker position on that team, so we had a lot of young guys that got some great experience, and I think as you look at it, we're able to draw upon those experiences in that state championship run.
And then one more year to set this thing up, and in 86 then things were really coming apart or coming together, and then it was an excruciating loss. I think it was the Rensselaer, wasn't it?
It was at Rensselaer, and it ended up being an overtime. And it was a game in which we had the game really totally in control. At halftime, we went in. We were ahead. They came out, and they ran a kickoff back against us, actually using the same kickoff return that we used with the reverse.
And oh, yeah.
We all sucked in, and they scored, and they got on a little bit of a roll.
Yeah.
And ended up winning it with a field goal kick. And it was that was one, I think, you know, if you want to talk about a game that was responsible for kids' dedication to their senior season.
Mm-hmm.
I think the Tim Walkers of the world, the Brad McMillans. Brad was a starter mm-hmm. as a sophomore in that game. Steve Bryant, Todd Brooks, all of those guys, Greg Biggs, Farricelli, Boyd, Goss, all those guys took that loss really, really hard,
mm-hmm.
as did the coaching staff.
I'm sure
and,
they did.
It was one that really we felt like you know, we should have gone farther that year, and very disappointing. But I think we took that loss with us into the offseason. I think we took that loss with us into the summer.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the results of that were a group of kids who came back pretty dedicated for the fall of 1987.
And then in 87 was the first year the Zebras participated in the Three Rivers Conference.
Yeah, it was. Very interesting.
And the Three Rivers was really a heck of a football conference in 1987.
Well, back then you had Woodco just coming off a state championship.
Right.
Of course, Valley had already won a state championship. You had a very good North Miami team and Coach Bob Bridge, who eventually won a state championship mm-hmm. and was runner-up in another one. Southwood with Coach Dave Wilhelm. It was a very good conference. Mm-hmm. It was a very tough conference to play in at that time. And, you know, we finished second or third
mm-hmm.
With two losses in the conference.
Yeah, I was
going
to say, in the middle of the season, you lost a tough one-point game to Tippecanoe Valley. I can remember a huge crowd. And to put it in perspective, as big as the rivalry is today, that was the first year of them being in the same conference. I mean, there was a little air that night, and Valley had a great team. Rochester had a great team. They made their touchdown an extra point. We made our mm-hmm. touchdown, missed the extra point, so it was a 7-6
And
game.
If you remember, Brad McMillan broke his hand in that ball game,
yeah.
and which played a key role in the next week,
right.
in which we lost another tough one to the defending state 2A champs, the Woodco
right.
Wildcats, and
had quite a few guys that had to sit that game. Didn't
yeah,
you?
We had you know, we were pretty banged up towards
yeah.
the end of the year, and that's what made the state championship run a little
right.
more special. You know, we had a quarterback who's playing with a partial cast on his hand. Tim Walker, we lost due to a sprained arch, and that's the first time and the only time I've ever seen that injury. And we could not get him healthy. I mean,
mm-hmm.
it was – and we tried everything, Eric, believe me.
Mm-hmm.
We sent him to the chiropractor. We sent him to the local witch doctor. we rubbed him down with horse liniment.
Mm-hmm.
We made him go home and spend the night with aluminum foil wrapped in some kind of a mixture that one of the local horse guys gave us. And we did everything to try and get him healthy, and it was – it was interesting. Nothing worked, but we also lost Kevin Herbst to a knee injury. You know, we played the last two games basically with Sean Kelly, a sophomore wide receiver, backup quarterback as our quarterback in those ball games. And you know, we gradually got healthy as we worked our way through the sectional and
okay.
and into the regional and semi-state.
Well, one of the things I wanted to bring up about the tournament run then is. Every team that wins a tournament, for the most part, has that one or two games that they win that they easily could have lost. And I remember the second game of the sectional, we played a very talented Madison Grant
team.
And we're behind late in the game
mm-hmm.
and scored late to win that game.
Yeah, we did. And I can tell you a little bit of a conversation that went on in the sideline. We're behind late in that game. We got a little bit of a we're really in our two-minute offense. And we are playing at that time because Walker just wasn't able to cut and wasn't very mobile. We're playing Tim at fullback, and we moved Steve Bryant, our regular fullback, into the tailback position. And we'd thrown, we got in a couple first downs, and I heard Coach Copeland over the headsets. We're going to run a draw on the next play. And I'm thinking, boy, if we get tackled, we're going to lose a lot of time mm-hmm. and we're going to waste the timeout and everything. And I'm going, are you sure? Yeah, we're good. And McMillan dropped back to pass, and he hands that ball off to Steve Bryant, who was, I don't think, was really ever known for his great speed.
Mm-hmm.
But our fullback, Tim Walker, comes up and they had a very good kid, made a huge block in that ball game, and you know, we end up scoring on it and winning the ball game. You know, it was amazing.
Yeah. So, one of the truly great games ever at Barnhart Field.
Yeah, there've been some good ones.
And another good one was two rounds later against a really good Western Boone team.
Excuse me. I just lost myself there for a second. We might need to edit some of this. But the Western Boone was a draw.
Oh, okay.
When Bryant went 50-some yards on the draw. The Madison Grant was Steve Ruckman's first field goal in his career.
Yeah, it was almost a 40-yarder, wasn't it?
Yes, exactly.
I couldn't remember those two
games. Yeah, I got them backwards. But, yeah, the Madison Grant game, we came back. Yeah. Ruckman kicked the field goal. I walked into that. That was another one. Steve was a remarkable kid, and he never lacked for confidence. Mm-hmm. I said, "You got this?" "Oh, yeah, don't worry about it," you know. And he did. He just banged it right through there. But the Western Boone game, they had an all-state middle linebacker that led the state in tackles. And on that draw play, Tim Walker went up the middle, hit that kid, and knocked him right on his rear end. I mean, totally planted him. Mm-hmm. And Bryant made a cut and broke one tackle and outran everybody else. So
the rest was history.
Yeah, the rest was history in that situation.
And then the one thing I remember about the fifth game, which was at North Newton, was one. It was a long drive, and it was cold.
And it was cold. It was very, very cold.
I always think of that as a Field of Dreams game because as a fan, you drive and you see those lights about – it seemed like they were next door, and it was still 15 miles away because it was so flat over there. It was about 8 degrees and maybe one of the coldest.
And the wind was whipping off the cornfields.
Yeah.
And our perch for videoing that game was up a telephone pole.
Is that right?
Yeah. As a matter of fact, Coach Brash came out at halftime and says, "I can't go back up there. It's too cold." It was remarkable. But to be honest with you, we didn't expect that we'd be playing North Newton. We went over after we beat Western Boone on a Saturday night because North Newton had to play Fort Wayne Bishop Lures. We were just convinced that we were going to end up playing Lures in the semi-state. And North Newton played a remarkable game against Lures. Lures never solved the option, and North Newton beat them pretty handily. So then at that point in time, we're going, well, can we stop their option? Mm-hmm. You know, because they had a kid named Spiller, a quarterback, a very good athlete, and then probably the all-state baseball player, actually played a little bit in the big leagues. A kid named Bernie Doyle was their running back and kind of their go-to guy. Very, very good player.
That had to be one of the really good games that you can remember in your career because you beat a really good football team by almost four touchdowns.
Yeah, we did. It was 27-0 on their field. We caught a huge break, to be honest with you. If you remember that game, the very first play from scrimmage, Doyle popped one right up the middle and went for a touchdown. However, there was a block in the back on Benji Dalton. Benji was playing outside linebacker because Walker still wasn't totally healthy. So we had Benji in there, and Benji came in to make a play, and the wide receiver shoved him in the back, and Doyle broke it for a touchdown. And fortunately, the officials caught it. Mm-hmm. After that, that was their offense for the night.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it was such a big momentum changer, and for us, it was huge. And that might have been Benji's the game of his career because he played very well in that game, had a key interception, and just did a remarkable job for us.
Good deal. So that sets us up. It's Thanksgiving week, 1987, and heading to, I guess it's not Lucas, it was RCA Dome in those days.
The RCA Dome, yeah. Actually, probably was just a Hoosier Dome at that time.
It could have been.
Hadn't even picking up the RCA sponsorship yet.
Hadn't got that $10
million. Yeah, exactly.
So what do you remember before we get to the game footage, which, by the way, was provided by, I believe, Bob Brash? It's going to be a little grainy, but remember, it's 25 years ago. The technology's not quite the same.
Well, I mean,
you had brown hair even. Yeah. So did I, probably.
That was, I did have brown hair then, yeah. Actually, my wife would say it was blonde, but.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, okay. Whatever. The technology, I mean, we taped that off the old VHS, mm-hmm. and then of course made a DVD off of that. So, mm-hmm. It's not exactly what we look at today in this day and age. But I think I'm not really sure who was filming. I think Bob might have been up top, and it's a fun game to watch. There's no question about that.
Okay, so. Enjoy the first half of the Zebras versus Indianapolis Ritter from 1987.
Quarters against North Newton, it will. And more on Rochester later in the week. Club trying to advance to the Class 2A Indiana High School football title game. The Zebras travel to North Newton tomorrow evening in a semi-state battle. If the Zebras win, it will be the school's first ever trip to a gridiron championship contest. Miller cites the community support as one of the reasons his squad is still alive.
Well, the community support has been fantastic. Last week, if you could have come over here, we're playing Western Boone, and they had signs all over the place. As Western Boone came into town, there must have been 40 or 50 signs for them to read, and they've just done an outstanding job. They've done anything that we've asked them to do. We have a very strong boosters club in Rochester, and they've been a very, very big part of our success.
Ritter for the Class 2A football crown. Yesterday at a coach's meeting, the Zebras head man Mark Miller got a tour of the facility. He says it's still hard to put in perspective that his team will be playing in the Hoosier Dome.
Find that difficult? Oh, I find it increasingly difficult. Our principal walked out in the middle of the Hoosier Dome and didn't have anything except holy cow and looking around and you know, if he's in awe of the place, you know what 16, 17, 18 year old kids are going to do when they first walk out onto the dome, and I'm not sure there's any way that you can possibly keep the whole thing in perspective. You just have to convince the kids that, hey, once the ball game starts, it's going to be like another football game. And it's just a matter of, you know, the butterflies will go away, you get a couple hits, and then we're going to be in the game.
The Zebras and Jimmies of Jimtown representing our area in the title games. I continue to share with you some items about the programs. The Jimmy fact for today, Bill Sharp's team is trying to become the school's second undefeated untied team. Gene Skirvin's 1970 squad was 10-0. And your Zebras fact is the school has two football championships. Jimmy's fact for tonight, no Bill Sharp coached team has ever had a record with an even number of wins. The 87 squad is 12-0. That means they should win, of course. And your Zebras fact, the high school's first points in a football game came in 1926. Doc Miller kicked to five, but his first win didn't come until 2 years later, 1957. And your Zebras fact for today, if Rochester wins Friday, it will be the school's third state title. The first was boys track in 1917, and the other, the 1980 boys golf crown. The school started in the late 1800s. It's been around a while. Mm-hmm.
And tonight, you know, Chuck Freebie has...
Coming up.
This special offer is
to be played tomorrow in Indianapolis. The top-ranked Jimtown Jimmies play Sheridan for the Class A state championship. Later in the day, the Rochester Zebras square off against Indianapolis Ritter for the Class 2A title. Rochester quarterback Brad McMillan has thrown for over 1,000 yards this year, including 9 touchdowns. Last week's dramatic performance against North Newton made Brad an easy pick for our WSBT Burger King athlete of the week.
Rochester has lost 2 games this season, but they've won 11, and Friday night they'll be playing for the state championship. A big reason for the Zebras' success has been junior quarterback Brad McMillan, who also sees double duty as he plays defense.
I didn't expect anything like this. We know we all hope to go to state, and we knew along with that would be the recognition, but, you know, we all knew in the back of our minds we could do it, and it's now that it's finally happening, and it's like we're all in a dream.
It boils down to one of the things, and that is the fact that, number one, as a quarterback, he has a really good feel for what's going on the field. Number two, as a junior, as a leader for us on the team, he's our junior captain. He's one of the guys in the secondary that is always thinking.
This is just probably one of the many honors you're going to have before Friday.
Well, first I want to thank my teammates, especially my offensive line and our defensive line. They do all the work up there, and if it wasn't for them, this wouldn't be possible for me.
So once again, Rochester will be traveling to Indianapolis for the state championship. This time, for the first time ever, they will not be going as spectators. The Zebras will be playing in the state championship. From Rochester, Jay Chapman, WSBT Sports.
And backs this weekend as the state championships in all 5 classes are held at the Hoosier Dome in Indianapolis. A surprising entry from this area is Rochester in AA. as the Zebras take on Indianapolis Ritter. Chuck Freebie has a preview.
When Mark Miller came to Rochester, the football team was near the bottom of the Northern Lakes Conference. But these are Zebras of a different stripe. And now Rochester is one step away from a Class 2A championship. For the team and the coach, it's a new experience.
In our situation, I told them I never had a chance to play for a championship before, so this is it. I think they are loose right now. They're ready to play. We won't be so loose when we get down on the Hoosier Dome floor and start warming up and practicing, and that's definitely a big concern.
But Miller doesn't need to be concerned with the Zebra defense. Last week, Rochester shut out North Newton 27-0, and Miller knows his defense has to come through again this week against Indianapolis Ritter.
We feel like we're very, very solid, and as long as the defense can be constant, we're going to go in there and get Ritter a good football game, and I think that it's easier to be constant on defense than it is offense.
There's no doubt the Rochester community is fired up about this game, and so are the players. But Coach Miller knows he's got to get his team on an even keel before Friday's date in the Hoosier Dome.
Well, they're having a good time, and there's been a lot of the perks, you know, people feeding them and everybody just saying great things about them. Hopefully, this is a very intelligent group of young men, and they realize the significance of the game, and I don't think they're going to get caught up in all of the hoopla.
Game time tomorrow afternoon in the Hoosier Dome is 4 p.m. I'll have highlights from Indy tomorrow night at 11. From Rochester, Chuck Freebie, News Center 16.
6 games.
Thank you.
Zebra. fourth and four.
Thank you.
midfield zebra. Thank you. Scott Jack. Second and about three, maybe four.
Fourteen.
7. 28 sweet goal.
Three.
sweet hook.
Okay, it's halftime now. The Zebras are down 6-3. What do you remember about the first half and what you needed to get done for the second half?
Well, for one, I felt like we'd left some points on the board. We did kick field goal, mm-hmm. But we had a couple other penetrations. We moved the ball up and down the field on them. We just didn't finish a couple of drives, which was a little bit disappointing. But, you know, at the same time, we knew Ritter was a very, very good football team. They had the week before, they'd beaten an outstanding, maybe the best ever Tell City football team to advance. And so, you know, down 6-3, I didn't feel like we were in too bad a shape. And so we went in, you know, we talked to the kids a little bit about keep doing the same thing that we're doing. You know, we felt like we had a good game plan at that point in time. And, you know, we felt like we were one play away from taking the lead in the ball game, which we were. And it was, you know, I think it was a very upbeat half. It was one in which maybe we made two or three little adjustments with blocking assignments, mm-hmm. and things like that. We came back out in the second half ready to play. Now, the first play of the second half might have changed things a little bit. And if you remember, in the first half, they threw a couple of outcuts right in front of Steve Ruckman. And Steve was just a quarter of a second from picking the ball and taking it the other way. Mm-hmm. And so they came out their very first play of the second half and decided to throw that little outcut with a pump fake. and had they thrown the outcut, Steve would have picked that off, mm-hmm. and went the other way. However, they threw the up, mm-hmm. and a kid named Goble took the ball all the way down, probably 65, 70-yard touchdown. And now we're behind 13-3, right. and you start wondering a little bit if we can hang in there.
Right. Now, you probably can get a good sense, I'm sure, over the years of being a football coach. Did the physicality of the team or the speed of Ritter, I mean, were the Zebras right there with them, or was there some air of, hey, they might be a little quicker than us?
No, you know, I they had a running back, a tailback by the name of Daniels that was a very, very good athlete. You watch, those of you people that watch it, you'll see a real good view of him putting a move on Steve Ruckman, and in their last touchdown run, in which he just kind of leaves all of us in the dust, mm-hmm. So you know, he was very, very good. The Parika boy quarterback, you know, had a good arm, but I think probably again, you said the made mention of the fact that we'd gone through a pretty darn good TRC schedule. Mm-hmm. And even if you go back the year before, you know, we were 5-2 in the Northern Lakes Conference against the Warsaws and Plymouths, mm-hmm. and Concords and those people, and you know, won a game against Northwood, and so I think our kids, you know, we were not in awe of what they brought. It was very similar to the same kind of competition that we'd be used to during the year. So. You know, we felt like we could play with them. And you and I were talking earlier, Eric, you know, you look at us up front. Danny Boyd was, you know, a 300-pounder who had great feet and could move. Mm-hmm. Brian Goss, a very, very good athlete, and a young man who was probably 245, 250. Todd Brooks, maybe one of the toughest kids that I've ever coached. At 215, 220 pounds as an inside linebacker and an offensive tackle. You know, our tight end was Greg Biggs. You know, Greg was 6'3", 6'4", 220 pounds. You know, our running backs, Walker and Bryant, were 195 and you know, right at 200 pounds, mm-hmm. just a little bit underneath. So you know, we were a pretty good physical football team, and I think we stood up very, very well against what Ritter was able to do to us in that ball game.
Okay. Well, enjoy the second half, and I think you'll enjoy the end of that second half more than perhaps the beginning of the second
half. Yeah, the end of the second half, the fourth quarter is remarkable, yeah. No doubt about that.
Yeah.
from the 5, 135 belly.
Thank you.
6, 476, tailback swing, 7 and 2, 7 and 1. 3 seconds. Thank you.
Yeah, you'll see him right off the top here. How you doing tonight? Well, a lot of things happening, but we got to give the high school football players a limelight here. First, it's a state championship in Class A. Sheridan got the break it needed to win its third title for Bud Wright in the third quarter when Jason Childers knocked the ball loose from Jimtown's Rob Lowe. Grant Delph returned it 23 yards to the Jimmy's 20, then Grant's cousin Tony took it the final 9 yards. Sheridan went on this win this thing. 10-0 is the final.
We played a good ball game, and they played a good ball game, but I thought that our kids really had the quickness over their team, and that was the difference, I thought.
Sheridan quarterback number 14, Jeff Durham, won the Mental Attitude Award. In Double A, Ritter was living by the passing arm of Vince Perica. This to Tim Roberts for a 6-3 halftime lead. But Rochester came back with two short scores from Steve Bryan and Tim Walker for a 16-13 fourth quarter lead. Long way from being over, the lead regained by Ritter's Damon Daniels on a 15-yard scamper. But here's Rochester's Steve Ruckman scoring the winner. 9 yards out, Ritter's final drive almost tied it.
That last minute was so long. They did a great job out there. I don't know. We just sucked it up so good. We played so hard. Just a tribute to all the seniors on this team. They're great.
And Double A titleist Rochester for putting forth championship efforts at the Hoosier Dome.
Three entering the third quarter, but Ritter quickly increased its lead. Vince Pericchia goes up top and finds John Goble all alone. 61 yards for the score. It's 13-3 Raiders. Rochester was down, but not out. The Zebra fans kept up their spirit, and their team gave them a reason to in the fourth quarter. The comeback starts on Steve Ryan's one-yard run to make it 13-10. Then Rochester takes the lead on Tim Walker's two-yard jot. The extra point is blocked, 16-13 Zebras. But Ritter's not done yet. Damon Daniels with some great moves, 15 yards for the score, 20-16 Ritter with 3 minutes left. Rochester has time for one more drive. Steve Ruckman from 9 yards out. That's a winner because Ritter will try a 41-yard field goal with 11 seconds left, missing wide left. The celebration is on in Rochester, and afterwards we talk with Coach Mark Miller.
Oh, unbelievable. I tell you what, when we were down 13-3, I felt like we could do it. We kept moving the ball up and down, and we missed some opportunities, and the kids just kept going. The defense came up with big plays all the way along the line. We bent, but we didn't break, and tremendous job.
For the icing on the cake, senior Tim Walker wins the Phil Askew Mental Attitude Award.
Dream come true day, all day. Oh, it's incredible. I love this. This is beautiful.
Indeed it is. The Zebras are state champs. The final, Rochester 23, Indianapolis Ritter 20 from the Hoosier Dome. Chuck Freeby, News Center 16.
Earlier on the day,
in the Hoosier Dome had ever come back a victor until today. The Rochester Zebra is now king of the hill in Class 2A, knocking off Indianapolis Ritter 23-20. Good contingent of Rochester fans, and saw their Zebras come out with a great win. They go up 3-0, and they need all of the points they can get as the Zebra fans on the sideline doing a little dance. Ritter's Vince Perica threw a couple of TD tosses. It's a rally a couple of times for Rochester in the final period. Rochester's Tim Walker, Mental Attitude Award. Good day all around. 23-20. They are the champs. And for
2A championship, Rochester and Indianapolis Ritter. Here's Ritter's Vince Pericchia throwing long to John Goble. 61 yards in the play. And this gives Ritter a 13-3 lead in the third period. We move now to fourth period action. Rochester sets up a touchdown with this pass from in close. Carries all the way to the 2 yard line. Moments later, Bryant scores for Rochester, and the rally continues. It's now 13-10. Ritter still on top. Rochester continues an amazing comeback in the fourth period. Walker scores from 2 yards out for the Zebras, The extra point is missed, however, and a 16-13 Rochester. But Ritter is next to score an amazing fourth period. Here's a 15-yard scamper by Damon Daniels. This makes it 20-16, Ritter on top. Now with less than 2 minutes to play of the game, Rochester setting up a scoring play. Check off at the line of scrimmage. The handoff is to Steve Ruckman. He gets his third touchdown of the game. And it is now 23-20 in favor of Rochester. Later, Ritter misses a third field goal attempt of the game from 41 yards out. It ends the scoring, and the final is 23-20. A Rochester comeback that's brilliant, winning the two-way championship.
Rochester came back in dramatic fashion. They were behind by 4 points with a minute and 10 seconds to go and scored a touchdown to win the state championship 23-20. Tim Walker wins the Mental Attitude Award for the Rochester Zebras. Congratulations to them. Class 3A champion.
Well, we just saw the end of it. The Zebras prevailed 23-20. What do you remember as your initial reaction after that scoreboard hit zero?
Well, the one thing I remember is hoping like mad that Parika's field goal didn't get there.
Yeah.
Because they had an opportunity for a field goal that would have tied it and put the game in overtime. Mm-hmm. It was almost a surreal feeling. I mean, we went into that fourth quarter and, we're down two touchdowns and we score one and they score again. And now we're in, at 8-9 minutes left in the game. We're still down two touchdowns. But our kids came back and everything that we called worked. Mm-hmm. We got a couple of big stops and made some huge plays in the ball game. We're able to get the win. So, I just remember, finding a Tim Walker and giving him a big hug and Danny Boyd and John Mitchell and some of those guys. And because, those guys had been through some tough times with that, with the early teams and yet, disappointed their junior year in the Rensselaer loss. But then to finish this way, it was just, it was a remarkable feeling. And, I remember, hugging Bob Copeland and John McKee and Tom Kelly and those guys on the sideline. And everybody was just ecstatic, a little bit tearful at that time because we had come from and how far this group of kids had come in order to win the state championship.
Well, at that time, you'd been head coach for maybe, I think you started, 80 or 81?
I started here in 1981. I actually was a head coach at Southern Indiana at Pike Central High School for 3 years prior to that. So,
right. So you came here as a young football coach with a little experience, but Rochester at that time was, let's put it bluntly, was at a low in football and maybe only won one or two games?
Yeah, we managed to come in the first year that I was here, and we won no games.
Yeah.
And then the second year, we improved a great deal on 1-1. Mm-hmm. Rob Schaefer would tell you that's because he came back in quarterback that year. That's why we won that one game.
Yeah.
And then we won two. So we were doubling our wins. We were heading in the right direction.
Things were moving up.
Right. And then in 84, we won four. Then our sectional in 85. And, we were fortunate. We had I had a great staff. I mentioned John McKee, Tom Kelly, Bob Brash, Steve Copeland, Mike Warledge. They were all people who were right there in the building that saw the kids every day and did a great job with them. And then we had a real special class. That senior class. My first year when I came to Rochester, many people don't know how talented I probably am because. I was the
certainly don't know.
The aquatics director when I first came to town at Rochester. So I taught swimming and had my WSI and lifeguarding and everything. But I remember meeting that class. They were sixth graders mm-hmm. the very first year, and that was one of the very first classes that I had. Mm-hmm. And I can remember Walker Bryant, Ferricelli, and that group of kids having those guys in class at that time and thinking, you know, this is really a neat group of kids. And as it played out, it worked out a little bit fairy tale like.
Sure. So, I mean, if you think about 6 or 7 years, you went from a no-win program to, hoisting the trophy at the Hoosier Dome. That's pretty remarkable.
It was, it was. And as I said, we had a great staff. You know, we had great support at the school. Dennis Ellendorf Hoffman, principal, assistant principal, all those guys were extremely supportive. And then you put that around a great group of kids to work with, and we had a lot of fun during that time, and we were very successful, very fortunate.
Another honor that was bestowed upon Rochester High School, and particularly one individual, is Tim Walker, won the Mental Attitude Award. I believe it's called the ESCU Award.
Phil and ESCU Mental Attitude Award is what that is. What that is, and. For boys football and Class 2A football, and that was a lot of times. Since then, I go down every year. I do awards with the IFCA, and you always take a look at. A lot of times, it seems like when one team wins, the other team has a Mental Attitude Award. Mm-hmm. So we really weren't expecting that, but Tim was obviously a great candidate for the award, and we double dipped him, so it was
a good day.
Yeah, it was a very good day at the Hoosier Dome that year.
One following question, since it is the holiday season here, the 87 team was obviously the most successful team you had in your 30 years plus here at Rochester. But was it your best team?
I think in terms of chemistry, leadership. And all those things, and we've talked about the talent. We've talked about we had kids that could run. Steve Ruckman was a remarkable athlete, mm-hmm. and Tim Walker was a remarkable athlete. Steve Bryant was a remarkable kid. Brad McMillan had an intangible about him as far as leadership and everything that you just don't find. Mm-hmm. I mean, he loved playing quarterback and he had his biggest game ever, on that stage. Mm-hmm. Was it the best team? Yes. Was it the most talented team? Maybe not. We've had some teams. That very next year, we had a very, very good football team. We were undefeated all year long and went and got upset ranked number one going into the playoffs. Got upset in a game over at Kinepokonoko Field in North Manchester, Indiana, one of my least favorite places to play, which, by the way, Manchester now has their own field, so we'll never go and play on that field again. And there's some bad memories there for me, a little bit of bad karma.
I can remember that game.
Yeah, yeah.
You played college football on that field, didn't you?
I did play college. That was part of the bad karma. We weren't very
just
good.
Just getting back at you.
We weren't very good, I think, yeah. But that team was very, very good. The 98 team that lost to Jimtown in the semi-state, and then Jimtown went the next week and just destroyed Clarksville Providence like 67-3 or mm-hmm. something like that. That was an outstanding football team, that whole group of kids. The team that won the sectional in 3A and lost a game that went right down to the wire against Northwood, which would have been Kyle Surface and B.J. Swank and Nate Sawyer, Tony Van Dyne. That was a very, very good football team mm-hmm. that had a lot of talent. But I think the state championship team not only had that talent but that chemistry, and that really was a difference of that football team in my mind.
Okay. Well, Coach, we want to thank you for coming. It's been it's been, I guess it'll be the 25th anniversary next year of that state championship team. So
it will be 25 years, yes.
So you're old enough that some of your experts.
I'm old enough to retire is what I'm old enough to do, Eric. So,
but we thank you for having the time, and we hope everybody's enjoyed reliving a part of Rochester's history. And like you said, there. The town of Rochester moved south 100 miles that day and supported the Zebras.
It was a neat, a very neat situation. You know that that was my first year as AD also. So that couple of weeks in there was I do remember falling asleep on my desk and having the night custodian wake me up during the week before the game,
mm-hmm.
and amidst tickets and passes and everything else during that period in time. So, I want to thank you guys. Obviously it's a special moment for me. It's a special moment for all those guys that I coach with, and hopefully there'll be some of the former players that'll get a kick out of seeing the game again and mm-hmm. and reliving some of those moments.
Yeah, and if you're a former player and you'd like a copy of this DVD, just call us at 223-2191. We'd be happy to provide one for you. So thank you, Mark.
Thank you, sir.